Hey there, welcome back to Pepper Geek. This video is all about questions regarding overwintering peppers. So we recently released a video about overwintering peppers, our detailed process on how we overwinter our plants. And based on the popularity of that video, I think a lot of you probably have overwintering plants right now. And there have been a bunch of follow-up questions in the comments and in our community tab about overwintering plants. As you can see, we got our first snowfall overnight last night. It's just about an inch or so, but we're definitely getting into winter here in New England. So without much else going on in the world of gardening, it's a good time to check on our overwintering peppers. So today I'll show you our currently overwintering peppers. You can see them behind me. And I'll go through some of the most common questions that we've been asked. Let's start by quickly looking at our plants. This one here in the green pot is an MOA Scotch bonnet pepper plant. You can see there's some green foliage on this. This was brought in when it was still pretty warm, so it shot off some foliage before going into hibernation mode. In this blue pot, this was the one from our overwintering video. This is the Numex Suave Orange pepper plant. Again, it has some fresh foliage, but it has since stopped growing once it got cold enough. And then behind these two, we have our massive ghost pepper plant. We had a harvesting video where we harvested all the peppers off of this plant. And due to popular demand, we decided to overwinter this one, but it was a little bit later. And I have some cause for concern about this one. I'm really not sure how well it's doing, but we'll talk more about that in a bit. Okay, so the first and by far most common question we got was, do I continue to prune the foliage when the plant tries to produce more leaves? During the overwintering process, we do recommend removing all of the leaves. That really mitigates the risk of bringing pests indoors when you bring your plants inside. But once they're indoors, they try to grow new leaves. Do I prune those off as well? And basically, you can do either. You can leave them on the plant and let it grow, or you can prune them off periodically. For the first few weeks, maybe 2 or 3 weeks after bringing the plants inside, we do prune off the leaves. The reason for this is, from our perspective, we're just trying to get the plants to go into hibernation mode and stay out of the way until they're ready to go back outside in the spring. And by pruning away the leaves every week or so, it keeps the plants smaller, more contained, more manageable, and out of the way. If you have a suitable location where the temperatures can be kept between 50 and 60 degrees, your plants will definitely reduce production of leaves, they'll slow down their growth and go into a hibernation mode. But there are some benefits to leaving some foliage on the plants, and that leads us to our next question, which is, how much should I be watering my overwintered plants? I touched on watering briefly, but essentially you're watering a lot less than you would be if your plants were outdoors. And there's a couple reasons for that. Number one is temperature. During the hottest days of summer, you might have noticed that you were watering your peppers every day or even twice a day in some areas. And that's because when it's really hot, your plants essentially sweat, it's called transpiration, through the leaves in order to cool themselves down. When they're indoors for overwintering and the temperatures are reduced, there's far less transpiration and therefore significantly reduced water usage. The other is growth rate. If there's not that many leaves on your plant, there's not much photosynthesis happening, and there's not much growth happening in your plant. Growth requires energy and water from the plant, so again, less growth, cooler temperatures, less water usage. So how do you know when to water your plants? They do still need water, they just need less of it. And one of the best ways is if you have leaves on your plants. If they start to droop, you know your plant needs some water. Now, as an example of how frequently we're watering, these plants haven't been watered for about a week and a half, maybe 10 days or so, and the leaves are still firm and upright. There's no sign of dehydration whatsoever. Another method to use to know when to water is to simply lift your potted plants and just get used to the weight of a watered plant versus a dehydrated plant. When I lift this pot, I can tell immediately that this has plenty of water in the soil. This one as well definitely doesn't need water at the moment. And as the plants use water or it's evaporated from the soil, you'll feel the weight of the pots decreasing and you know they can use a drink. And one last option is to use one of these moisture and pH and light meters. They're really cheap, so it's not that big of a commitment, but they also don't really work all that well. I find it's best to take a reading when you've just watered so that you know where that puts it, and then sort of judge the moisture level comparatively as time goes on. For example, if it reads a 4 just after you've watered and it goes down to a 2 or a 1, you know that it's probably time to water. But these you just stick right into the soil, go down a few inches and you'll see the moisture meter jump up to about a 3 right now. So it thinks it's pretty dry, but I know there's enough moisture in there for now. Now, when you do water, don't add too much, just a little drink of water, enough to saturate the soil, but not enough for it to be pouring out of the bottom of your pots. And just in case you do add too much water, make sure that you do have good drainage off the bottom of your pots. Okay, so our next question is my plant dead? That's a really good question. You know, should I waste my time watering and checking on the pepper plants throughout the entire winter just to find out that it's dead come spring? And that's a question we're kind of asking ourselves right now with this back plant here. This is our ghost pepper plant. Again, we showed you harvesting all the peppers off of this plant, and a lot of people in the comments said we should overwinter it, so we decided to give it a shot even though it had already gone through a couple of nights of freezing weather. Since bringing it inside, it hasn't grown at all. I haven't seen a single lick of green color off of this plant yet, but it's also been really cold. It's been out here on our breezeway where it's in the low 40s and probably lower than that some nights, whereas these plants we brought into the basement where it's a little bit warmer. So if your plant hasn't grown any leaves and it looks like a stump, it's turning brown, there is a chance that it's dead. We did mention this in the overwintering video. There's no guarantee that overwintered plants are gonna survive. It's a very traumatic process. The one way to test to see if your plant is alive is to bring it into warmer temperatures. So bring it into a warm, well-lit room. Upper 60s, lower 70s are ideal. And if the plant is alive, it should bounce back and start to grow some green. As soon as you see any green, you see a small bud coming from any node on the plant, you know that it's alive and it's doing well. You can put it back where it was in a cooler climate and wait for spring. Now I'm gonna do that with that plant in the back and test to see if it's alive or not. And that should really only take a week, maybe 2 weeks to see that growth depending on the temperature. That leads nicely to our next question, which is overwintering worth it? What are the benefits, drawbacks? Does it save time? Do you get better yields? Do the peppers produce well, etc.? The main benefits of overwintering are preserving genetics. You're keeping the exact same plant, so you know that it has the exact same genetics. It should perform equally well, and just keeping alive a plant that you like. A lot of people get sort of emotionally attached to their plants, and they just don't want to see it go, so overwintering is a way to keep that plant going. In terms of benefits versus drawbacks, we've never really done a one-to-one comparison. We might try growing one of these varieties from seed and then compare the results in a similarly sized pot just to see which one produces better. But even that's really not scientific. It's just one plant versus one other plant. The seed that we grow the other plant from could have some drawbacks to it. It could have some genetic mutation. You just never know. It's really not a one-to-one comparison. But anecdotally, yes, I think there is some benefit to overwintering. The plants have a much more established and strong root system right off the bat, and it requires much less work. When you're growing seedlings, you're watering them every day or two in the early spring. You have to do a lot more to get young pepper plants off to a good start than you do an overwintered plant. You basically just take these and put them into a well-lit room, whereas seedlings, you're running grow lights early in the season, you've got a heat mat to get those seedlings off to a really good start, humidity domes, lots of equipment. And if you're just growing one or two pepper plants, it may be worth it to just overwinter them, keep them alive, and not worry about all of that seedling stuff. But I will say, in my opinion, I prefer starting from seed. I like the process of planting seeds every year. We also plant new varieties every year, so we're always planting from seed anyway. And if you plant at the right time and you provide good care for your young pepper plants, they should do just as well as an overwintered plant. Another question we got is, are there alternatives to overwintering? And yes, there are. If you want to keep the genetics of your plant alive, but you don't want to go through that rigorous task of uprooting a plant and cleaning the roots and repotting it in new soil, you can just propagate your peppers. We haven't yet done a video on propagation, but essentially you can just snip off one of the branches, ideally one of the branches that is currently growing, so at the top of the plant, put that into some water in a cup on a sunny windowsill, and then wait a few weeks until it starts to grow roots. Once you see roots forming, you can put it into some soil or into hydroponics, whatever it is, and that will essentially be a clone of the original plant, maintaining all of the genetics, and it should grow pretty rapidly from there. And the last question we got is it absolutely necessary to clean out all of the soil from the roots and repot it in new soil? Can you just leave the plants in their current soil and do something else to kill off pests and not worry about that? And the answer there is absolutely yes. We tried something different with this back plant, which we didn't show, and that is to use insecticidal soap to soak the soil, which will kill any bad insects that are living in the soil and kill off any eggs that may be there as well. So we use this insect killing soap concentrate, which you dilute into some water, and then watered the plant really thoroughly. Ideally, you would submerge this into a bucket of the insect killing soap and leave it there for maybe 10 or 15 minutes, and then skim off the surface of the water before removing it and allowing it to drain. A few other people also recommended putting a thick layer of sand on the surface of your soil, and that should prevent fungus gnats and other types of insects from coming up through the soil surface. If you do end up with insect problems, you got aphids or fungus gnats, you'll just have to figure out how to deal with that specific pest. Again, insecticidal soap is probably your best bet for most cases. You're not gonna have beneficial insects indoors to take care of your aphid problem indoors. Indoor pest problems are really bad. You don't wanna have to deal with them, which is why we take extreme measures to prevent it in the first place. So that's all for this video. I hope this helped you out with your overwintering peppers. If you have any other questions, please feel free to leave them in the comments below and we'll be happy to help out. Thanks for watching Pepper Geek, and I'll see you next time.